Good morning, church. Oh, wow. Very nice, very nice. It is my joy and privilege to welcome everyone to this time of worship of Creevewood Baptist Church. To all who are weary and need rest, to all who are lonely and need a friend, to all who sin and need a Savior, whosoever will come, this church opens wide her doors. We do welcome you if you're joining us online this morning as well. And if you are a guest today, we do extend to you a special word of welcome. And in the pew rack in front of you, you have a card that looks a lot like this. And I invite you to take that card, fill out it out with the requested information, and return it to me. I'll be waiting in the pastor's corner after the service. That will be on your left on your way out. And we have a special gift to you from the church at that time. In Pastor Ray's absence, we welcome back to the pulpit Eli Hadad, president of Arab Baptist Theological Seminary in Lebanon, not Lebanon. And Larry McCullough will be making the introductions later on in the service. Today begins the week of prayer for North American missions, and prayer guides are at the entrances this morning, also in our Fellowship Hall lobby. You may give to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering in envelopes, and there's tithe boxes behind you. On your way out, you can put your envelope there. And you may also give, of course, online and or via the Realm app. Would you join me in prayer, please? And as we enter our time of prayer, we'll start with praise. Lift up your own prayer of praise to God. In Revelation, John writes, "Then I heard every creature in heaven, on earth, under the earth, in the sea, and all that is in them singing, 'To the one seated on the throne and to the Lamb be praise, honor, glory, and ruling power forever and ever.' This is the God we worship. Lift up silently your prayer of praise." For our time of confession, the psalmist wrote in Psalm 51, "For I am aware of my rebellious acts. I am forever conscious of my sin. Against you, you above all, I have sinned. I have done what is evil in your sight. So you are just when you confront me. You are right when you condemn me." Spend time in your own prayer of confession to God. We come now to our prayers of thanksgiving. Our thanks to God flows from who we are in Christ Jesus. In Colossians we read, "Devote yourselves to prayer. Be watchful and thankful." Pray your own prayer of thanksgiving. Last, you may be burdened this morning, burdened for the world condition, for others close to you, for yourself. Acknowledge that to God. Who are others you need to pray for right now? Lift up your own prayer of supplication. And now let us pray as our Lord taught us, using debts, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture today is from Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words whose voice is not heard. Their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom leaving his chamber, and like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them. And there is nothing hidden from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. Who can discern his errors? Declare me innocent from thy hidden faults. I think there was supposed to be something else there. My printer stopped printing, evidently. And I think it's something to the, may the words of my mouth and meditation, is that, I'm sorry. Will? My printer stopped. I did get that right. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and redeemer.
Amen.
Good morning. If you're able, why don't you stand up and worship with us this morning? I'll praise in the valley, I'll praise on the mountain, I'll praise when I'm sure, and praise when I'm doubting. Come on, sing it out. I'll praise when I'm numbered, I'll praise when I'm surrounded, I'll praise in the water.
Hey, good morning, everybody. You doing okay? Now, Miss Martha is gone today. She is visiting a friend in Georgia, and she promised me that she was going to watch us on the computer. So if you want to, you can join me in saying hello to her. You want to do that? Yeah. Say, hey, Miss Martha. Hey, Miss Martha. All right. And she's with her friend Jacqueline, but sometimes Jacqueline finds it hard to get out of bed in time. So, we'll hope that Jacqueline is with her. Okay, a while back when I first came to this church, and everything was still so new to me, and I was still getting to know the people, there was this little kid, and he walked up to me, and he had a very important question to ask me. Do you want to know what he asked me? Here's what he asked me. He said, "Why is your head so big?" No, he really did. He asked me why my head. Why would you ask someone a question like that? Well, obviously because they have a big head and you want to know why it's so big. You got to know the reason. And I told him the reason. I said it's because I have such big brains. And, you know, if you have big brains, you've got to have a big head to hold them. Yeah. Well, I have a huge brain, so that's why I've got such a huge head. But I got to thinking about that today. We all like to ask questions because we all want to know. And then I thought of a question maybe you would answer for me. And that is, why does God love you? Why? Yeah, he does, but why? Is it because you're beautiful? You're not beautiful? Okay, well, you said it. Because you're handsome? That's it? So if you weren't handsome, he wouldn't love you? Does he love just smart people? No. Because he what? That's it. Oh, yes, good answer. I don't have any stars to give you, but I owe you a star, all right? Okay. Yeah, that's it. God loves you just because he made you. And he made you different than anybody else in the world. You're special to him. Each and every one of you are his special creation. And that's why he loves you. And you know what? He made you that if you wanted to, you could love him back. Now, don't you think that's good news that we should be telling everybody? That God made you, God loves you, and you can love God. Well, that's a much more important question than why do you have such a big head? You know, but we all have to start somewhere, right? Right. Okay. So now you don't have to ask me that question in case you were wondering. All right. Yeah. You were wondering, weren't you? Yeah. Okay. Well, I think I have a song around here somewhere a bit. Oh, you want to hear it? Okay. Yeah. I'll let you know about my tour dates so that you can come. All right. Oh, I think you'll enjoy this. You mind if I sing it for you? Okay, here it goes. Why in the world does God love you? Is it for something you've done? Is it your beauty? You're just such a cutie. Or maybe the trophy you've won? There is one reason God loves you forever with all his heart. It's just 'cause he made you and he wouldn't trade you. There's nothing to keep you apart. Rah, rah, rah. Why in the world does God love you? Maybe you do well in school, or maybe you're funny, or have lots of money, or maybe you're just really cool. No, 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 there is one reason God loves you forever with all his heart. It's just 'cause he made you and he wouldn't trade you. There's nothing to keep you apart. Let's go, God, rah! Okay. Now, see, aren't you glad you heard that? Let's say a prayer and then I'll send you on your way. Oh, dear God, thank you that you love us and that you made each and every one of us special. Oh, Father, help us to love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There's only a few of us in the room that know that was the University of Nebraska fight song. Would you stand with me if you're able?
Breath in our lungs, so we pour out our
together to Him. You give life. You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. So great are You, Lord. It's Your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's Your breath in our lungs. So many things, God, that we rightly celebrate in our lives, but only You are worthy of our praise. Thank You for Your love. Thank You for Your grace. All the earth, Lord, will shout Your praise.
Yes.
God, thank You again for this time in this space. We love You. Amen. You can have a seat. I'm going to invite Larry to come up and introduce our speakers this morning.
Seven years ago, our church entered into a global missions partnership with the Arab Baptist Theological Seminary in Beirut, Lebanon. A few short years after, Rob Schiffman, who's currently the chair of our deacon board, and I had the privilege and the opportunity to see firsthand the ministry there and to visit with students and faculty. This morning, it's my delight to be able to introduce three representatives from ABTS. First of all, Laula Malouf is the Director of Partnerships there. And Laula has been with us a couple of times before.
She's recently engaged in a PhD program in leadership. And then Dr. and Mrs. Eli Haddad. Eli's wife, Miriam, is a tutor in the Certificate of Ministry program there at the seminary. Born and raised in Lebanon, Eli Haddad immigrated to Canada towards the end of the Civil War in 1990. He worked there for 15 years in Toronto as a senior consultant in the area of information systems and management. And while there in Toronto, he enrolled in the Master's of Theological Studies to prepare for ministry. In 2005, Eli and his wife, Miriam, felt called to return to Lebanon, where as the global field staff of the Canadian Baptist Ministries, Eli joined the faculty of Arab Baptist Theological Seminary, serving as provost until 2008 when he became president. First of all, Laula is going to come and share a brief report on the ministry there, followed by Eli Haddad to bring us the morning message and sermon. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry. Good morning. It's my pleasure and my privilege to be with you this morning. I bring you greetings from the Arab Baptist Theological Seminary and fellow Baptists in Lebanon. Grateful to worship with you this morning. So as you know, ABTS is located in Beirut, Lebanon. Lebanon is a very small country in the Middle East, and it's a very unique country. We have a lot of challenges. We had the pandemic like everyone else, but on top of that, we had an economic crisis, a social crisis. We had a Beirut explosion in 2020 that crippled Beirut. We have to worry about everyday things like where we get our electricity or where we get our water from. You hear all this bad news on the news, of course. But what you don't hear is how God is at work in Lebanon and in the region. We are able to reach Arab-speaking countries by serving them and training and equipping leaders. So God has been drawing so many to know him, whether visions or dreams or people who are suffering and searching for hope, they find hope in Christ. We've been seeing this in Lebanon, in Syria, in Egypt, in Algeria, in Yemen. So the harvest is definitely plentiful, but the workers are few. This is why at ABTS, we are called to serve the church in our region, and we do this by training and equipping faithful men and women for effective ministry. Our students come from different parts of the Arab world. We have Moroccans, Algerians, Yemenis, Lebanese, Egyptian, Sudanese, and all our students are people who love God and love their communities. They want to share the love of Christ with their communities. Despite the difficulties and the challenges that they face, they want to go around sharing the love of Christ. A few years ago, we had many Sudanese students. Larry and Rob met some of them while they were in Lebanon. So these students went back to Sudan. They started going to unreached areas, sharing the gospel. God used them to plant new churches. Their ministry was flourishing. And then, less than a year ago, a new civil war erupted in Sudan. Many of them had to leave everything they had been working and building and escape the area. They went to a new area, sometimes a different country. Some of them went to a nearby country. And God used them there. So we see them there sharing the gospel, starting home group meetings, Bible studies. We see their pictures on Facebook all the time. Despite the challenges, despite their churches being burnt down, they encourage us by sharing how they are comforted by the word of God. They encourage us by how they continue to share the love of Christ wherever they are. So like the first church, wherever they are scattered, God uses them to preach the gospel. So we are really encouraged by that. And my hope is that you are encouraged to know that you are a part of this work as partners with ABTS. Together we can train local leaders who have a heart for their communities, those who want to stay despite the difficulties and spread the gospel, whether in Syria, in Lebanon among refugees, in Yemen, or Morocco, or Algeria. I want to invite you to keep our students and graduates in your prayers. Sometimes the worries that we have in Lebanon are the least of their worries in their own countries. So I want you to keep them in your prayers. Pray that they continue to be steadfast, to be ready to obey God's calling wherever they are, to continue to be changed into a Christ-like servant. And I want to ask you to continue praying for the Arab world, that God continues to bring many more to know him. So thank you for hearing me, and thank you for your partnership.
Good morning. It's great to be with you again. I'd like to read this morning from the Gospel of John, chapter 10. This passage is probably a favorite passage for many of us. I'll be reading the first 18 verses, John 10, 1 to 18. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. This figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep, and I have other sheep that are not of this fold, I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. Amen. This is a fascinating allegory. Unlike other parables in the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, it is not connected with the story. Jesus plays two key characters in this allegory. Jesus is the good shepherd, and Jesus is the door. This parable depicts the shepherd as the one having authorized access to the flock. It compares the faithful good shepherd with the faithless shepherds of Israel of that time. This passage follows the previous chapter, chapter 9, where Jesus is addressing the spiritual blindness of the Pharisees. This parable also talks about the door. Doors are important in our lives. First, the door is an image of salvation, of belonging. Jesus, the door, is our access to God. This is the door of salvation. We go in through the door, who is Jesus. We come into the fold and become part of the flock. Jesus calls us by name, and we end up knowing his voice. We can now discern between the shepherd and the thieves. The door is our way to eternal life. By entering through the door, we are saved. But secondly, the door is our source of safety and protection. The thieves avoid the door. This door has power. It cannot be opened and closed by others. No one can manipulate this door. The thieves that come to it get exposed right away. This door protects us. This was the extent of our understanding of the door in our churches. And I will come back to this passage later, but our churches, we grow up in majority Muslim world. We're minority. Our churches grow up very much in survival mode. We just want to be left alone. Ministry is about what happens inside the four walls of the church. It's about congregational care. It's about self-care. We're not concerned with others. We're not concerned with Muslims. We don't love them enough. We're not concerned for them enough. Ministry is about us, and we want to be left alone. So the door for us meant safety. We are safe within our own community, our own congregation. However, something is significant that's happening in our region. Failed Arab Springs, war in Syria, refugee crisis, extremism and ISIS and all of that that took place, political crises, financial crises, economic crises, all of these things in the region, Middle East and North Africa. God is using what's happening in the region, all the conflicts and violence, to shake the church. So what's happening is, as God wants to draw people to himself from the Arab world, from the Arab Muslim world, and you've heard from Lilua, God is drawing people to himself in large numbers like we had never seen before. You know, the whole mission world has been praying for the 1040 window to come to faith in Jesus Christ. The whole Arab world fits within that 1040 window, and it's happening in front of our eyes. God is bringing people to himself in large numbers. But in order to do that, what he's doing is that he's shaking the church and he's transforming the church. And our church that grew up in survival mode has really changed. If you come and visit Lebanon today, the church is very different from what it was during the Civil War, 1975 through 1990. We're learning so many lessons. One, we're learning to love the others. We're learning to love our neighbors. You know what happened during the Syrian refugee crisis? The majority of Syrian refugees were Muslims, of course, and they're coming into Lebanon. Within a span of a few months, we got 1.5 million refugees come into Lebanon. Lebanon is a small country of 4 million people, so you can imagine the stress that caused the government and people, the economy, the infrastructure. Everything was strained. And our survival mode churches, because of the tension that we have between Christians and Muslims, because of the tension that we have between Lebanese and Syrians, because of their involvement in our civil war, our Christian Lebanese churches were the least likely people to be caring for Syrian Muslim refugees. But that changed. The church was transformed. The Holy Spirit impressed on people's hearts to start doing something different. So we're learning to love them. We're learning to love what used to be our enemy. We're learning to love our neighbors. And we're gaining a deeper understanding of what gospel is. What does it mean to proclaim the gospel? We used to think that proclaiming the gospel is only verbal proclamation, and that's it. It's not our call to help people, humanitarian aid. That's the work of World Vision. That's the work of United Nations. That's the work of NGOs. But the church should be only concerned with verbal proclamation. Well, we discovered a much deeper meaning to what gospel is, a multifaceted gospel, which is word and deed. We do both together, integral mission. We're learning how to do that as a church. We're learning how to care for the body and the soul of everyone that God brings into our circles. We're learning how to proclaim Christ. We had been proclaiming Christianity for a long time. Now we're learning how to proclaim Christ. In our part of the world, religion is very cultural. It's an identity marker. Someone is a Christian or someone is a Muslim. That does not necessarily mean that it's about their faith in Jesus or in God or whatever. It's about the community that they belong to. Everyone belongs to a certain religion in Lebanon. We are born into the religion of our parents, religion of our family and community. So proclaiming another religion, an alternate religion, has not been or had not been an appealing invitation to invite a Muslim to defect to the other side, basically, to drop everything that belongs to that community and then join another community which they are in tension with. And that happened in small numbers, but that created always a lot of alienation. But now we're learning how to proclaim Christ. Jesus did not come to start a religion. Jesus is supra-religious. He came to draw people to himself from every religious background, in every nation, in every tongue, in every people group. And that's happening. So it's not about whether we invite people to join a religion. It's about inviting people to have a relationship with Jesus, no matter what their background is. And that has a world of a difference in terms of impact, in terms of strategies for mission and evangelism. And the important thing for this morning is that we're learning how to read our Bible differently. The passage that we read, we used to read verse 10 this way: Jesus came so that we may have abundant life. The abundant life is inside the fold where it is safe. We come into the fold to be saved, and we are safe inside the fold. But now we're learning that the door is not just about safety. Verse 9, just before verse 10, it says, Jesus says, "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture." It is a two-way door. It's not a one-way door. We come in for salvation. We come in for belonging. Then we go out. We don't stay in. The pasture is out, is not in. We missed that reading before. We come in through the door, who is Jesus, to be saved. Then we go out through the door, who is Jesus, following the Good Shepherd, who is Jesus, because, as he tells us in that passage, there are sheep that are not part of this fold that he wants to bring in. The work of bringing people into the fold is outside the fold, not inside the fold. We come into the safety, then we walk out with Jesus into where it's not safe. That's where the pasture is. The abundant life is not inside the fold as we used to think. The abundant life is after coming into the fold, going out to engage the world. The abundant life is engaging in God's mission around the world. That's where the abundant life is. That's where the pasture is. That's what we were missing in our understanding of the Bible. So God is really preparing his church for something totally different in the Arab world. And, you know, at ABTS, we learn a lot from our students. Our students come from places where it is much more difficult to follow Christ than it is in Lebanon. In Lebanon, we have a degree of freedom. Religious freedom is guaranteed by our constitution. We can have that freedom. But the rest of the Arab world, people may pay a high price for their faith and for their ministry. So we learn a lot from them. We learn how to read Acts 12 differently, the story of Peter in prison. The way we used to read the story is that Peter was in prison and the church was praying for him to be released from prison. And then he was released at night. He came, knocked at the door. They were late in opening up. And we interpret that being lack of faith or whatever things we interpret that. But that's not what the text says. If we go back to the text and look at it carefully, it does not say that they were praying for him to be released from prison. It says that they were praying for him in prison. They knew, the apostles knew, and the churches knew in the first century, and our students from these countries, they know that if you proclaim Jesus, then you'd likely end up in prison. That's what happened in Acts of the Apostles. Sometimes God released them from prison and he was glorified. Sometimes he did not release them from prison and he was glorified nevertheless. And all of the apostles, their ending is not that beautiful. They had to pay a high price for their ministry and for proclaiming Jesus. We hear that all the time from our students. We learn that from them. Usually we tend to think in our comfort that God is obligated to spare us from any kind of suffering and that we should pursue the path of least resistance when we're making decisions. You know that this is a type of prosperity gospel, even if we don't acknowledge it. But what we are learning, we're learning theology of the cross, a gospel that includes suffering with it. We proclaim Jesus. We stand up for what Jesus says. We take Jesus seriously. Then we will likely pay a price for that, whether this is in the U.S. or this is in the Arab world. It's the same. We will face some kind of hardship and persecution if we follow Christ and if we take him seriously. This is what we're learning from our students. And it's fascinating to see what's happening inside the Arab world right now resembles a lot the first century church. There's a lot of evil, but there's a lot of divine intervention. God is at work reaching people, and we're seeing visions and dreams, and we're seeing miracles, and we're seeing answers to prayers, and we're seeing people that are willing to die for their faith and be imprisoned for their faith. A number of years ago, we had a couple from Algeria. Algeria is a country in North Africa. 20, 25 years ago, there were a few hundred believers. Today, there are more than 100,000 believers. And the story of their church growth is filled with people put in prison and leaders facing hardships for their ministry. At the time, our education was still fully residential, so students would come to ABTS, stay for 3 years. We required them to go back during the summer to remain connected to their communities, but it was a residential program at that time. So we had this couple from Algeria, and they had a small boy with them. And at that time, there was a lot of persecution of leaders. They were imprisoned. So at the end of the first academic year, towards the end, we found out that there was a list of leaders in Algeria who were sentenced to go to prison, and our student, his name was on that list. So we came to them and we said, well, if you are threatened that you would be sent to prison, you can stay in Lebanon for the summer. We'll take care of you so that you don't have to face prison. You know what they said? They said, no, we're going back to our country. There's nothing that they can do to drive us away from reaching our community with the message of the gospel. The sentence is 3 years. If they put us in prison, we'll go to prison for 3 years, then we get out and then we continue ministry. That's what they said. And our student, he had a lot of medical issues. There was no guarantee that he'll be taken care of inside prison. But these are the kinds of leaders that God is raising in the region. They went back to Algeria. Fortunately, the sentences were suspended, and then they came back to ABTS and finished their education, and now they have an amazing ministry in Algeria, discipling university people. So this is why you see something different changing in the Arab world. You don't hear that on the news because the news, they like to say things that sell. This doesn't sell, but God is actively at work. And it's just exciting to be just a small part of what God is doing in the region. And God is raising these kinds of leaders that we are learning from them how to read our Bible differently. So this is the thing that I want to leave with you today, is that in the middle of this mess, in the middle of all the conflicts and violence that we are in, God is leaving a strong witness. Our churches, who used to be survival mode churches, just minding our own business, now they're finding their prophetic voice. They're finding that God has put us there for a reason, and we are there to be on mission with God. That's where the pasture is. That's where the abundant life is, out there reaching people with the message of the gospel, reaching people with the message of his love and his grace and his salvation. So God is at work, And we are so grateful that we have partners like yourself who are coming alongside us and enabling us and empowering us to equip leaders who are faithful witnesses to God in the middle of hardship. Let us pray. Thank you, Father, for Jesus, who is the good shepherd and who is the door. Thank you for the fold that we can come in and be saved. And thank you that you don't leave us in the safety of the fold, but you walk in front of us as we go back out to find people that need to come into the fold. Father, in our region and everywhere around the world, there are so many people that need to be saved and pulled into the fold. So help us, Father, find this pasture outside. Help us be focused on what you're calling us to do and to be faithful in taking your gospel out into the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Would you join us in thanking Pastor Ellie for preaching for us today? Pastor, we didn't know that you would be preaching about the faithfulness of the Good Shepherd when we chose to close the service with "Great is thy faithfulness." So I'd like to invite you to stand and join us. If you need someone to pray with you, if you would like to make Creevewood your church home, Pastor Will is down front. So as we sing, you can come down front if you want to. Let's sing this together. "Great is thy faithfulness."
Today and bright hope for tomorrow.
Thank you so much for sharing this morning. Allow me to bless us, and we'll be dismissed. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord turn his face toward you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.